Spoilers for the life of a man who lived over 200 years ago and has a whole era named after him. When retelling a thrice-told tale, the real tale is in the telling. Theater lovers who are used to musical revivals and Shakespeare productions know this maxim well. When you know the what of a story, the how takes on so much more importance. Look, the webtoon Blown Apart and the Fire Emblem-style game Banner of the Maid convinced me that proper Napoleonic geekery was finally here to stay, to stray in from outside other eras' shadows. Then IGN gives lots of short jokes, and Jeremy Johns talks about accents and complexes. You can keep your Romaboos and your Panzers and girls, except for the Powerpuffs.
Story's all wrong! Napoleon's 1807 seizure of Portugal and the subsequent rebellion by the Spaniards cost France over 300,000 casualties, untold sums of money, and contributed to the eventual weakening of the Napoleonic Empire.
And your analysis on the invasion of Russia is also incorrect. Napoleon's invasion of 1812 resulted in massive casualties of his troops due to starvation and inclement conditions and ended in a disastrous retreat from Moscow with his army defeated!
Yeah, dummy! And when he returned to France, the allied nations of Europe united against him, which led to his eventual defeat at the Battle of Waterloo on June 18, 1815, where after he was exiled to the island of St. Helena, where he died a miserable death from stomach cancer on May 5th, 1821. Stupid!
No, stop!
You can leave your Supermen, Batmen, and Megamen. Napoleon is my superhero. History is my cinematic universe. And the Age of Revolutions is my series. So what's the great Ridley Scott, that reviser of the historical epic, gotta compete with to gain my Mojo Jojo-like approval? Horatio Hornblower opened the floodgates, but it was the PBS's hours-long documentary, voiced by David McCullough, that really sunk those bayonets in. My first actors, as opposed to cartoon, depiction of Napoleon was Christian Claver in the epic 6-hour 2002 Napoleon series. And I maintain Ukrainian studio GSC Game World's Cossacks 2 is the best depiction of Napoleonic warfare out there, and thus one of the best games ever made. Yes, my favorite movie is Master and Commander, and I'm happy with my hours played in Napoleon Total War. Bonafide's proven, then. So what did I think of Ridley Scott's take? I actually kind of liked it. Sorry, Brandon. Any historical film is an act of sculpture, and that's especially true of the life of Napoleon. What you leave in and what you cut out really shape the movie itself. Enough maneuvering. On to the Gunsmoke. The movie starts with the terror and the execution of Marie Antoinette. I like the sequence and the time scale. Why not give the terror and the death of the Bourbons as the inciting incident? Actually having Napoleon at the execution, though? Then Toulon. Awesome. Entertaining sequence. Though Napoleon scouting out the fort himself, I'm noticing a theme here. For the amount of time this movie focuses on the revolution, I would have loved to have heard the words Federalist Revolts. And that they timed it with the fall of Robespierre and the Thermidorian reaction, it makes sense, I guess. Felt a bit awkward, but I do appreciate the thoroughness in showing the broader context of the revolution. I loved the sequence of Napoleon's defense of the Directory from a royalist mob. It shows you just how brutal Grapeshot was. Whether a whiff, or several, or a whole army.
In the shade of olive trees, they said Italy could never be conquered.
First Italian campaign skipped. Makes sense, but missed an amazing action scene opportunity. The Egyptian campaign is there. It's not great. Kinda goofy. As was Napoleon's coup. I don't mind the goofiness there, though. And I appreciated the focus on fellow conspirator and consul Sieyès. And to mention the coup of 18th Brumaire, they don't show the revolutionary calendar at all. Which I get because it's so confusing, but that seems like something that would have fit in with the movie's themes better. Showing Napoleon getting rid of the old calendar would be neat. Marengo is also skipped, fine. Many do. Sorry, horsey. The movie only haltingly attempts a global focus on the era. It is nice to briefly catch glimpses of General Dumas. But Scott misses a major opportunity by not having First Consul Bonaparte mention the word Haiti.
In the West Indies.
I was born there. My father owned a plantation with more than 200 slaves. It was a paradise of sunshine and sugar.
A major focus of the movie is European diplomacy, which makes me extremely happy. So how is Scott's Talleyrand? Interesting. Very different from what John Malkovich did. More oddly calm than deeply intense. I do like it. Napoleon becomes emperor because of diplomatic fears instead of an assassination attempt like in 2002. He is disdainful of British boats. I thought it was funny and captured his lack of tact. Others may disagree. Would have been cool to see Charles Cornwallis, the man of the British Empire who was involved in the negotiations. Coronation to emperor was fine. Austerlitz. The ice sequence looked pretty, but tactics are done most dirty. It was in the snow for some reason, combining it with Eylau, maybe. Loads of guys just running around and shooting. No formations, it looked just awful. I know Ridley Scott can shoot great battle scenes. It's what he's known for. He does better battle scenes in this very movie. But the whole goal of the sequence thematically is not only to capture Napoleon's greatest victory on screen, but also to show why it's his greatest victory and why he was and is so beloved. How did these tactics actually work? You wouldn't know from Scott's take. Even the freaking Patriot has better battle scenes because at least they are in lines. On the other hand, I love Napoleon's meeting with Emperor Francis after Austerlitz. The Austrians are usually forgotten, but not here. Prussia, however, and her Shinji-like king, was skipped. A missed humor opportunity, all things considered. Ridley Scott's juggling act between so many different elements has been admirable, but it's around the piece at Tilsit that the movie really starts to fall apart. Getting the timing of events wrong, I do appreciate Napoleon's bit with Marie-Louise. I would have liked more. Spain is skipped, which I don't think was the best call considering the themes at play. But the invasion of Russia was excellent. I loved seeing the guerrilla tactics of the Cossack partisans. And the brief Battle of Borodino looked great. The actual taking of Moscow and retreat were underwhelming after that. Jumping right to the abdication was fine, it made sense. I was extremely impressed seeing Alexander with Josephine, a truly excellent unification of themes. Napoleon returning to Elba because of her, I get it from a narrative and structure perspective, but didn't she die while he was on Elba? There's a great but short sequence at the Congress of Vienna. I'm a huge Congress of Vienna nerd. I think we are even rarer than Napoleon nerds. We were ignored by the 2002 movie. Also, a missed opportunity to call back to the beginning with the royal family screwing up again. Of the three major film depictions of the surrender of the 5th Regiment of the Line, Waterloo, 2002, and this one, I like 2002 the best, maybe because it was my first. Tiny nitpick. They got Austria's flag wrong, but it's like everyone does that. Waterloo had one amazing sequence and one good sequence, but they were balanced out by so many stupid ones. Amazing. The British infantry advance and form squares. Good. Napoleon's cavalry fighting among the British squares. And the stupid? A British rifleman whose rifle has a spyglass as a scope. I almost want to give credit to this very American movie for even having a British rifleman in it. Soldiers in the trenches, even being told to go over the top. Peabody and Sherman did this in their animated series a few years ago. Finally, Napoleon leading the charge himself. The last one, stupid as it was, could work thematically if it didn't happen. Napoleon has too far gone to be the same type of man when he was young, charging the bridge at Arcole. But while I have been giving the Napoleonic greatest hits play-by-play, it's only half the movie. for all the scenes of history being made in war. Napoleon's relationship with Josephine is ultimately Scott's focus. So, how are they together?
You are just a tiny little brute that is nothing without me.
Somewhat compelling. I actually liked how the scene before this one was written, where Napoleon tells Josephine the same thing. Good turnaround. Napoleon sure is horny. Scott shows him dogging Josephine a lot. And Hollywood movies focused on Napoleon's romances are nothing new. He had more mistresses in 2002. But it was the second time the future imperial couple interacted that I realized what this movie was actually about. Josephine's son asks the general to return her dead husband's sword. From listening to the amazing podcast Age of Napoleon, I know that that's a constructed myth. Like the whip of grapeshot, to the bridge of Arcole, to the pyramids, to ripping the imperial crown from the Pope. Scott's Napoleon is more about the legend and the myth than the man himself, even by showing the man's personality as utterly ridiculous. I can certainly see Napoleon's sexual appeal, weird fellow that I am, or that power hides a lack of it. And, after all, in dynastic states, the royal family's ability to reproduce itself is kind of a big deal. And so, the strongest scene between Napoleon and Josephine isn't them making love on a bed or under a table, but their official divorce proceedings. Two people with a strong, if strange and strained, personal bond submitting to the mechanics and roles of state. Napoleon painfully insists on this fact and demands Josephine insist on it too. Love really is a weaker bond than power. Napoleon's empire, for all its pretensions as something new, is really just another kingdom based on rules of power instead of real human joy.
You certainly have changed. After doing all you could to destroy the monarchies of Europe, now you're going to bed a crown.
This is not about bedding, Josephine. It's for reasons of state. Don't cry, please. It's not worthy of you. It's not worthy of us.
I'm not crying. Only little girls cry, and I haven't been a little girl in a long time. Which is why you're getting rid of me. Because I'm an old woman. You no longer love me, Napoleon. That's the truth of it. The only truth. You don't love me.
Stop the acting. Come home. Get up. Someone might come in.
And yet, the true best scene of the movie is after Waterloo, when it's all over. Napoleon talking to midshipmen in London, and their love of listening to him. That's where this line from the trailer is from.
I'm the first to admit when I make a mistake. I simply never do.
We see a little more of it on St. Helena. And none of this. Or this. Napoleon just falls off his chair, and the movie ends with a list of battles and a list of the dead. And that ultimately hits on one of Ridley Scott's major themes. That the Napoleonic myth and legend is as much a childish fantasy as Spider-Man, or Sonic the Hedgehog, or Luke Skywalker.
Tell them all that they were wrong about me. That I'm not a monster. We can't have you going away with such a gloomy impression of me.
Have you finished dictating your memoirs?
Almost.
And what have you said about me?
Nothing.
Because I'm not worth it. Because you ruled the world and I am just a stupid little girl.
the imperial crown of France will contribute less to my legend than the crown of thorns England forces me to wear now. But you are not a thorn. Far from it. So you have no place in my legend. But in my heart, it's a different story.
For over a century, that's what he was. Even to these guys. And these guys. I personally disagree with Scott's assessment of Napoleon, but I do respect it. It also explains why Austerlitz and Waterloo are the way they are. Scott is trying to say that all the artful armies and beautiful battles and smoky, fiery geometry and colors and sounds of combat are all the real illusion, meant to hide all the killing. And I somewhat disagree, but respect that too. But what all these battle scenes and love scenes and diplomacy scenes show is this critical fact. For all his sense of destiny, Napoleon is not alone. He is embedded in a whole world, a changing world, which he is one part of, even if he is a very big one. This sense of embeddedness is achieved by focusing a great deal on the material culture these people lived in. How did these different types of cannons work? What did people do for fun? How did it feel to survive the terror? Embeddedness is achieved most effectively through, of all things, the sound design. Scott popularized the wailing woman in Gladiator, but he uses and variates on it beautifully here. We see revolutionary tunes during the terror, Russian ballads at Russian battles, and Corsican wails throughout. I will happily agree that this movie goes much too far in denigrating Napoleon instead of showing why he had and has such a cult of personality, one I myself join in. This diminishing is balanced not through shaming the man, though there is certainly a lot of that, but by focusing far more on his context. Behind him in the French Revolution, around him in European diplomacy, and within him in his relationships to the woman in his life. For all the power crowns give, true love is an even greater power. Did the artilleryman turn emperor find it with Josephine? Or is power his greatest love? Scott's focus on context also applies to the film's subtext. How many people like me think of Napoleon as a real-life superhero buying into the myth? Yes, Scott wants to subvert the myth, and he does it by showing the world alongside it. And that's why I actually quite like Ridley Scott's Napoleon, because I love his era more than the man himself. Bringing it back to Shakespeare for a second, this movie isn't that, but it's kind of a parallel attempt. I can see Ridley Scott wanting to tell Macbeth through Napoleon's life. It works. The star is the witches. Josephine is Lady Macbeth, and Wellington is Macduff. Maybe this is all a medium problem. Napoleon should obviously have gotten a Hobbit treatment. Spielberg will be doing a miniseries based on Kubrick's old script. Apparently there's an anime in the works too. Napoleon needs more video games as well. Even so, we Napoleon fans will be back to eating good for the first time in 20 years. I'm happy to mount Marengo and see what's next. Scott's Napoleon is far from perfect, but hopefully it's a springboard to an even greater depiction.